The views expressed in the following program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of Saga 960 AM or its management.
I'm Annie Koshy, and I'm glad that you've joined me for In Focus with Annie J Koshy, where I'll look at people and their milestones, places where international changemakers are impacting our world, as well as events that bring our communities together. You can tune in on Saturdays at 4 p.m. to News Talk Saga 960 AM. Follow 960 AM on Instagram and FB, and you can follow me as well on Instagram under Annie J Koshy or under GTA South Asia Media Network. As the executive producer of Good Earth Productions, Mitch Azaria has overseen over 200 hours of factual production. He has been honored with a Hot Doc Award and 7 Gemini nominations. Prior to Good Earth, Mitch was a reporter and anchor for Global News and Global Sportsline. Now, Mitch was part of the TVO original, Tripping the Niagara, a stunning documentary that enables viewers to fly like a red-tailed hawk along the lower portion of the Niagara River. Welcome to the show, Mitch.
Great to be here, Annie. Thanks for having me.
It's a pleasure, and it's a pleasure on multiple levels because for me, you've done something that's completely up my alley, and that is created along with an entire crew and team documentary film. The audience in this film will soar over 24 kilometers of one of the most beautiful areas of Ontario. Now, along the way, they will visit historic forts, vineyards, orchards, the treacherous white water, and the most famous of all waterfalls. Let's talk about this process of creating this documentary. Why did this story matter to you?
You know, it's surprising, right? I mean, you saw it. I didn't, my impression of Niagara Falls was Horseshoe Falls, Clifton Hill. And, you know, when we talked about where we were going to go, because we had done a first episode last year on the Rideau Canal. And, you know, it was a very sort of traditional, well, traditional in this, you know, area of filmmaking that is, you know, experiential, where the viewer is, you know, is essentially on for a ride. And that was a boat ride. And when we thought about what we wanted to do next, we thought about another boat ride. And we thought, hey, you know, that's kind of been done. And we talked to TVO, and we had this crazy idea, like you said, of, you know, flying like a red-tailed hawk. And we thought of anywhere, Niagara. I mean, it's an area that's incredibly surprising. As I said, you think of the falls, you think of Clifton Hill, but there's way more to it. I mean, there's parts of that river that look like you're in, you know, the Colorado River with, you know, 17-story high gorge and white water, as you mentioned. So, you know what? Now I forget your question. Did you ask me?
It was a process of why did this story matter to you? Why was it that you chose, of all of the different places, you could have done the Kingston Locks, you could have done, you know, another part of Canada, you could have gone to the Rockies, you could have gone to so much beauty within Canada itself. We have the best environment. We have the best wildlife. We have the best natural settings, the most scenic lakes, pristine waterways. And yet you chose the Niagara, and it's a story, or it's a place that's been visited quite frequently. So why was it that this story mattered to you?
Yeah, you know, when you put it that way, it is kind of curious, right? And I think it's exactly because of that. It's that it's a place that everybody thinks they know. And I thought I knew,
right?
But it's not what I think it is. What I love to do is take somewhere or take a subject that people think that they know something about.
Right.
And as you know, right? And then you sort of, you know, you take them to a place that they just didn't realize was there.
So what was the process of the research like?
Well, the research was quite concentrated, and it was done during the pandemic. So it was, you know, it was sort of fast and furious. So the first thing my director, John Morrison, and I did was we thought, okay, well, let's go from one end of the Niagara River, which is actually quite a short river. It's only 54 kilometers long. So let's tour the entire river. And, you know, for the most part, you can stay close enough to the river either by, you know, by car or by foot to see it all. And we quickly realized that this was just a place that we couldn't, we never fathomed. It was, as I said, 17 stories, white water, forts along it. There's a part where when you're coming up to the falls, you see all the, you know, all the water tumbling over and you see the foam. And what you don't realize is there's thousands of fish falling over those falls that are landing on the bubbles and surviving. And
right.
It's sort of a place that is unexpected.
I see that this conversation that we're going to be having today with you, Mitch, is going to actually be very fascinating. And we call it the Niagara River. However, the river is not quite a river. It's connecting two lakes. It's considered a strait. Typically in North America, rivers run north to south. This strait actually runs south to north, and it's quite interesting to see that. And you're absolutely right about the fish. Most of the fish end up surviving when they land at the bottom, unlike the humans who have gone over the top of the Niagara Falls. Now, it's quite interesting to hear you say, it's a 3-hour documentary. What helped you decide the core story points and the elements that helped to make your, you know, the documentary sort of tingle to sort of bring it alive to the viewer, for example?
Yeah, well, we realized early on that as much as the Niagara River was sort of the spine, that it's what the Niagara River influenced, right? Which is the entire area.
Right.
So, you know, why are the orchards there? Why are the vineyards there? Why are the forts there? Why are the botanical gardens there? Well, I mean, they're there, you know, partially. And I should start by saying, yes, it's a 3-hour, you start on Lake Ontario, and for 3 hours, you're a red-tailed hawk. So you're up in the air, you're flying, and you're a curious hawk. You know, at some points you want to be on the river, at some points you want to go off the river and go into Niagara on the lake and, you know, see what that, you know, beautiful historic town is. Why it's there. You see a fort, you want to go over to that, then you kind of come back to the river. So you're this curious hawk going all the way up. And, you know, what we found was that it was somewhat dictated by the limitations of a drone.
Right.
A drone is a specialty camera. And as you know, most times drones are shooting sort of 1 minute, 2 minutes, you know, it's an opening,
right.
It's a continuity shot. It's not necessarily a 20-minute shot.
And so I'm going to come back to that, because the drone shooting of that is quite interesting. And I want to talk about another film that's come out that they've shot using a drone in the U.S. that's making huge impact right now. So don't jump on that gun yet. We've got. I want to unpack this. Totally unpack this. Before we get there, however, I want to ask you. You had to do some digging for leads, etc. Was that easy, or did you have to were there official letters and permissions and things that were really a struggle? This is interesting, because as a documentary filmmaker myself, it can be a challenge, you know, when you are exploring historical lands.
It's a real challenge, and luckily, that the interesting part also is that the entire area from, you know, Lake Ontario to Lake Erie, that 56 kilometers that goes along the river, it's a park. It's an Ontario park. So it's got, you know, all of the regulations that a park has. And you probably know, you know, shooting within a protected space can be very challenging. So
absolutely,
we did have the cooperation of Niagara Parks, but, you know, there were some real challenges because it was a park, because there's people in it. Because as you know, we'll talk about later about being a drone, but that, you know, that's got some inherent danger in it, right?
Right,
and there's
right.
Serious regulations with that.
Well, we've been in conversation with Mitch Azaria, and we're talking about the TVO original, Tripping the Niagara. It's a stunning documentary that enables all of us to actually view and fly like a red-tailed hawk along the lower portion of the Niagara River. You're being tuned into In Focus with Annie J Koshy here on Saga 960, and I am going to take a short break right now, but we'll be right back. We're going to be diving right into the history of this Niagara region so that we can get right into the bits and pieces of how this film has actually come together.
Stream us live at saga960am.ca.
That you join me for In Focus with Annie J Koshy, where I look at people and their milestones, places where international changemakers are impacting our world, as well as events that bring our communities together. Now, Niagara Falls, their history began a long time ago. It was built by glaciers. In studio today is Mitch Azaria. He's the executive producer of a production company that has been involved in the production of this film. Good Earth Productions was involved with the TVO original Tripping the Niagara. Mitch, welcome back to the show.
Thanks, Annie. Great to be here.
Let's talk a little bit about the history that went behind this entire area. We have the Niagara Escarpment. For those people who are listening, because not everyone is here in Toronto who are listening to this show, it is going to be available on podcasts, and so other people do tune in from around the world. What is special about this region?
Well, interesting that you talked about the history. So, the lower part of the river, the part that has Niagara on the lake, the part that has the orchards, the part that has the vineyards, was once part of an ancient lake. And what Lake Ontario is, and we see that, in Toronto, this Lake Iroquois went quite high. It was much larger than Lake Ontario. So right. When it receded after the Ice Age, not only did it compress the land, but it lift its bottom was so mineral rich and so forth. And that gives, birth to these great lands that allow for, the vineyards and the orchards. And so that's sort of what's on the ground. Then you get, Lake Ontario, giving it sort of that that hot water bottle effect, so that in the spring it gets longer warmer temperatures, and that allows for Niagara to be as they call it the fruit capital of Ontario. I think it's 80% of all the fruit grown in Ontario is or consumed in Ontario is from Niagara. It's very well known for that. And then, the human history is incredibly interesting. I mean, it goes back millennia. The fact that Niagara on the Lake was, Canada's first capital, before Kingston, before Ottawa, it was Niagara. And that was in 1795.
It was a huge passageway for things to be brought in, goods to be, traveling, especially with the St. Lawrence River and any waterway that was used, because that was how goods traveled, right? Now, the startling green color of the Niagara River is actually a tribute to the erosion that this water has over the rocks. It's estimated around 60 tons of dissolved minerals are swept over the Niagara Falls every minute. Now, that fine color comes from two things. One is the minerals, but also the fine rock dust that's actually ground rock, I would say, that comes from having been picked up by the water. And there's a lot of limestone and whatnot that's around in that rock area. Now, this area extends right into Milton, which is, towards the south, towards the north. And it is, there's that sheer cliff that we know as the escarpment, which has provided a sort of a shield for that entire region, which creates a sort of a unique area of warmer climate, more fertile soil, very rich area of Ontario.
Yeah, you're right. It is a microclimate, and it's and you really sense it there. I mean, they get very, very little snow. It is, you know, it is quite warm. It's got, you know, for wine especially, it's incredibly important because, you know, for grapes, they're trying to get the grape to, you know, stay on the vine as long as possible and really concentrate those sugars. So if you get, you know, long summers going into a mildish fall, that's better for it. And it's interesting what you said about the color of the water. It's, I don't think you notice it so much when you're at Niagara Falls, when you're, you know, when you're looking at Horseshoe Falls, you get the sense that there is some sort of greenish tint, but I think it really forms and you really see it further down the river because it is getting those minerals off the cap of the fall. So, you know, it's not quite present immediately, but once you get down, you know, a few kilometers and you can see the river, it's, I think what surprises me and people should look for this. There are, I don't know how many, countless viewpoints all the way down the river that you can stop, pull over your car, or if you're on a bicycle, you can pull over and look at and see the color of the water. It's astounding, the emerald color. And again, you know, you sort of mentioned it, but because of that erosion, Horseshoe Falls, which are, they call Horseshoe Falls, the Canadian Falls, the American Falls, and Bridal Falls. So there's three right. sets of falls, although right. we think of them as one Niagara Falls. Those falls, 12,000 years ago, were 12 kilometers downstream.
Absolutely. Now, there has been an erosion of about a meter every year that has pushed the falls back further and further.
Yeah, I mean, there was a spot, and this is something people visiting Niagara Falls can do. There's a plaque on the lookout looking over the falls, and it talks about where the first European explorer, because not settler, it was settled much later, where the falls stood when they got there 400 years ago. And you can see it's 400 meters from the falls. I mean, wow. You know, and you can stand there and just imagine, oh, that's where the falls were the first time, you know, they were seen by a European. And then, you know, landmarkers down, there's an area that's called the Whirlpool, which is quite famous. It's sort of this big sort of circular area.
Right.
And you can see that, you know, that was probably 6,000 years ago when the falls were there. That's actually a really interesting spot to visit the Whirlpool and to go on the aero car that goes across.
Right. Now, the waters of the Niagara River are used by a combined U.S. and Canadian population. They use it for drinking water, recreation from boating, swimming, bird watching. They use it for fishing. There are industrial uses for it, with the water being used as cooling water supply. There's also hydropower generation with the New York State Power Authority, as well as the Sir Adam Beck Station in Ontario. Was that any of that captured, the actual uses of the water in the film? And what was the information that was being conveyed with that?
Yeah, I mean, it's... I think up until 1980 something, it was considered the most polluted river in North
yes.
America.
Yes, I recall watching a documentary then, Mitch, in which it was shown, I believe in high school. I know it's dating me, but it was at that point. And I remember it was a guy in a canoe and he was going down. And then at one point he's rowing along and he dips his mug into the water and he drinks, and then he dips it in and it's foamy and frothy with environmental pollutants that had polluted the river. And at one point, Environment Canada was very concerned with the contamination of the water there.
Sure. I mean, we remember Love Canal, you know, there was incredible dumpings of, you know, waste material into the river, and it was the most polluted river in North America. And both the American and Canadians decided to change that. And now it's, you know, it's not fully recovered, but it's a very, you know, healthy river. You know, the fish populations have come back, bird populations, the corridor is incredibly incredibly healthy. But yeah, I mean, that's, you know, if you were asking about some of the recreational components, you can get on a jet boat because, you know, remember that these currents going up the river, some of them are, you know, when you get to a place called the Whitewater Walk, there's six class six rapids. I mean, the right. most dangerous in the world. I mean, boats actually can't get into that. But just prior to that, there's these class five rapids. Anyway, you can get these jet boats and go up the river. And, you know, I'm always a little leery about that kind of, you know, attraction. I think, yeah, you know, that sounds a little touristy. It is the most fun. You get to see, you know, how beautiful the river is. And then you get to see what you were talking about, these power plants.
Right.
And these power plants are, I mean, they took, you know, 4 or 5, 6 years to build. They are gigantic. And even today, they're still powering or creating enough power for, I think it's 2 million homes in Ontario. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're really relevant, you know, pieces of not only history, but pieces of, you know, of what's currently sort of, you know, generating, you know, power for this province. Incredible to see.
Now, we spoke very briefly about the abundance of wildlife. Now, the subtitle of the film is A Bird's Eye View. The primary character was a red-tailed hawk. And I say that he was a character because he does have this very, very haughty, hawkish look, you know, where he looks over his shoulder like, huh, I'm here sort of thing, right? I love him. Now, the indigenous say that if you keep seeing a hawk with white feathers, it's something very sacred is about to take place, and the creator is giving you a message that a miracle is on the way. How and why was this particular bird chosen?
Yeah, so, it's a great question. So we thought that red-tailed hawks are a bit on the rise in Ontario, and they're, if you're driving along the 401, there's the bird that you're going to see mostly, or the hawk that you're going to see mostly, and you know, you see them a lot because they're perched in trees or perched on a wire. They're only starting to perch on wires recently because they don't want to waste energy. So they're, you know, scanning and they're looking. So those are going to be red-tailed hawks. They're just an absolute gorgeous bird. Why did we choose a red-tailed hawk? For those reasons. Also, again, because we were filming in the pandemic and there's only, you know, a certain amount of, you know, wranglers that were working, and we found someone, we wanted her to work with a red-tailed hawk. She loves red-tailed hawks. So she has a bird. His stage name is Striker.
Which is great. Look at that. He's got a stage name. Do you have a stage name, Mitch? I'm wondering about that. Now, the hawk is a courageous bird, just like an eagle. The hawk does represent strength and courage of the warriors. And in fact, it's compared to the eagle. If you compare it to an eagle, a hawk is actually swifter and attacks a prey in a more decisive manner, which I didn't really realize. So it's interesting that you were able to use this hawk. You had the trainer there with you, and Striker, was he difficult to work with?
Yeah, well, Striker was moody. He's very moody.
Wow.
He's curious, but he's moody. But his stage name might be Striker, but his real name is Stickers. And he got his name because if you watch the film thinking about this, every time he's about to take off, a really wild hawk will take off immediately. They won't hesitate in any way, because hesitation in any, you know, in any wild animal is not a good thing. And you watch this guy and he hesitates and then he goes. And so he got the nickname Stickers because he kind of sticks to his post before he takes off. But he's very moody. The thing about, you know, most companion animals is you can say to a dog, you know, come here, you give him a treat, and he'll come back again. You tell him to sit, you give him a treat, he'll sit again. Well, hawks aren't companion animals.
Fetch boy doesn't work. This is quite interesting. How did you do the hawk drone sequences?
Yeah, so that's the thing, is that you can't get a hawk to do what you could get a companion animal to do. The only thing that they sort of understand is food, but not in a food way, like a reward way that a companion animal, because they're also wanting to make, you know, their human happy. That doesn't go with a hawk. I mean, a hawk is, they will do something for food, but nothing, you know, nothing more. And they don't care about you. I mean, they just want, well, though it's, I seem to think that our wrangler had quite a relationship with stickers, but it's not the kind of relationship you have with a companion animal. Anyway, he was very moody. There's days, and he only worked, you know, a couple of minutes a day. It wasn't like he had a really, really long work
day. I think I need to come back in my next life as a hawk, with a wrangler. I said a trainer. There are wranglers. I remember it sounds like they're in a bullpen or something. Yeah. It's quite interesting to hear all of this. And you had to have a drone fly similarly to that of a hawk. We're going to come back from the break right now. We've been in conversation with Mitch Azaria. We're going to go right into the drone sequences and how shooting with a drone was and can be quite challenging for most filmmakers. And it's not as easy as you think without a license. You need to have the licenses now, and there are a lot more things that you have to navigate when you're shooting with a drone. So we're going to come back after this break. You've been in conversation, or I've been in conversation with Mitch Azaria, and we've been talking about the TVO exclusive Tripping the Niagara, A Bird's Eye View. You're tuned in to InFocus with Annie J Koshy here on Saga 960. Stay tuned. I'll be back right after this message.
No radio? No problem. Stream us live on saga960am.ca.
Welcome back to In Focus with Annie J. Koshy, where I'm in conversation with Mitch Azaria, executive producer of the TVO exclusive Tripping the Niagara, A Bird's Eye View. This exclusive TVO documentary can be seen no matter where you are in Canada at tvo.org on demand whenever you wish, starting on the eve of April 2nd and going forward. The documentary can be seen on any day at any time from that date onwards. Welcome back, Mitch.
Thank you, Annie.
Well, I want to dive right into a part that we've both been holding back from talking about. And I was like, no, don't talk about it yet. And that is the drones. Oh, my gosh. Let's talk about how a drone imitated a hawk and what that process was like.
Yeah, I mean, drones are, you know, it seems like in the last few years that, you know, lots and lots of folks are flying drones, and they're a wonderful tool. And so I'll just give you sort of the 101 about drones. A drone, no matter what size, can only stay in the air for, let's say, 15, 16, 17 minutes. So you'd say, well, you know, just put a bigger battery on it and then it can stay up longer. But if you put a battery, that's more weight means it can, you know, so it's this yin yang, but that's kind of the drone's maximum time. So we wanted to fly like a red-tailed hawk, and we watched hawks for a long time to see how it is that they fly. And what they don't really do is pan and tilt and crab. And that's kind of what, you know, drones do. They talk about compound moves in a drone. So that's when the drone pilot is, you know, moving the drone in one way. And then the DOP, the director of photography, is moving the lens in another way. And it's a wonderful thing when you're building a, you know, an opening to a big feature film, or you're revealing something in a big feature film. And guys and, just people can shoot drone for a minute and it's just spectacular. But how do you film for 15 minutes without interruption, where you're going, you know, between trees and around houses and up in the air and then back down to the ground, you know, landing smoothly? So we were really fortunate that our DOP from last year, Peter Warren, who's Ottawa-based.
Right.
Not only has he been a director of photography for 40 years, so he can frame a shot without thinking. It's like the way that we drive a car. Like, he just does it without thinking. He knows exactly where the horizon should be. He knows about the lighting. He knows everything. So that part he knows immediately. The other thing he's been doing for about 25 years is he's got a simulator because he loves flying airplanes. And then for the last 5 or 6 years, he's been flying a drone. So it's the perfect combination. A guy who doesn't have to think about his frame, because that comes to him innately, but can then just think about how to fly this drone without hitting anything and, you know, be smooth for 15 minutes. And it means right. that you've got a thumb on each toggle. Right. And all you have to do, if you just slightly, you were talking about that you don't drink caffeine, you don't want these guys drinking caffeine, because if you just slightly move your thumb, you know, it just throws the whole shot off. Everything has to be perfectly smooth. So it was an incredible, incredible challenge. And, you know, you saw the dock, like we were in, you know, we were in some crazy places that a drone maybe shouldn't, you know, well, it's allowed to be, but it's a very difficult place to be.
Right. Especially in that scene where you've got it with the old houses, and we go through that neighborhood where there's a lot of low tree branches. And you at one point with the drone have gone below some of those tree branches, and we're watching and listening to the cars pull up to the stop sign. And then we get the imagery of all of these houses and how they're built close to the road. And the particular reason for that is when their housing was built. We're going to get into the historical aspects of this area. Now, the Niagara region is, it abounds in monuments, in museums, in former battlefields. We also have a lot of heritage structures. The documentary used animated sequences bringing to life some of the major historic events along the way, from Fort George in the midst of a battle. And we also experienced what it felt like to be in Niagara-on-the-Lake in the 1850s. Now, the film embeds historical facts in interesting ways throughout, which helps to really enrich the viewer's experience, dispersing Niagara facts, you know, of the area. What were some of the surprising things, Mitch, that you learned about the Niagara area?
Yeah, that's a great question. I'm going to answer that, but the thing that I remember a John Grisham story where he was in a really, really busy time of his life, and he was taken to, you know, one of the most beautiful gorges in, I think it was in India, but he was in such a rush. He was in such a rush, and he kept saying to the guy, okay, let's just see it. And he kind of went and kind of, you know, hiked, you know, for 10 minutes, looked and ran back to the car. And, you know, 20 years later, when he, you know, was in a better place in his life, he said, one day I'm going to have to go back there and see it.
Right.
And that's what I always think about, that if you show people a landscape, and if it's just, you know, a shot of the landscape, they'll say, you know, that's a beautiful place. But if you tell them what happened on that landscape, either historically or natural history, all of a sudden, you know, they appreciate what they're seeing at a whole other level. So, you know, for us, we wanted to, and we talked about this right at the beginning, we wanted to give people a deeper appreciation of what they were seeing. You know, Niagara-on-the-Lake, you know, we talked about it being the first, you know, capital of Canada. And, you know, why that was, we talked about it strategically being at the mouth of the river. And if you could control that river, as you talked about, and the goods that could come up that river, then you were in control of the heart of the continent, because that's going up to the upper Great Lakes. It's going down to the lower Great Lakes and out right. to the St. Lawrence. So you could ship goods up and down.
Right.
Well, you know, that's an important thing. Niagara on the Falls, Niagara on the Lake, you're talking about why houses were built, you know, close to the road. They did that, and it was kind of a first because they wanted to have bigger gardens in the back, because gardens were, you know, the place where you entertained, but was also the place where you grew food. So, right. you know, yes, you were moving into a town and you were used to being on a farm. You still want to be able to, you know, to feed yourself.
Right.
You know, so some of the surprising things, well, we talked about the moving of Niagara Falls, those class six rapids are incredible. Clifton Hill, you know, why is Clifton Hill, like, people know that as the sort of entertainment area.
Yeah, it's like the Vegas of Niagara, I would say, with all the flashing lights. You know, everything's turned on all the time. And more so now, I don't remember it being so much so bright and Vegas-like, you know, with all the lights and the LED lights and whatnot. But it is like that now.
Yeah, and somebody was telling me that a lot of the great natural history places in the world that you go to, and it's sort of a pilgrimage, you know, to the pyramids or I guess that's not a natural history, but to these great, you know, sites, that they're often accompanied by the absurd. And it's that you take in so much sort of, you know, reality of you know, either humankind or of natural history, that you then need your brain to go somewhere that's completely bizarre. And yeah. they were mentioning a few places, and I thought, I'd never really thought about that. Why are there 5 haunted houses on Clifton Hill, you know?
Yeah, what do those haunted houses really, what are you saying? Is Clifton Hill is haunted? Now, do you have any suggestions of places that you visited that you've never seen before? Because you and I are here in Toronto. Niagara Falls is not something unusual. We have been there umpteen times. I think one summer we as a family had 14 visits to Niagara Falls because we had a lot of guests that summer. So it was the go-to place, right? That Niagara Falls and Ontario place. It's the CN Tower, Niagara Falls, and Ontario Place. Those are our 3 prime locations, right? And I think we just had a revolving door between the 3 of them that summer. And this was when I was a kid. You and I have been to Niagara Falls. It's my go-to location when I need to see water. Is I go there and I stand right at that corner where the water is going over the falls, and I can actually film it. Crazy nut that I am, because I need to see that swoop of that water going over to like no man's land, right? So we've done it all the time. What was special this time? And did you find things out that you never saw before?
Yeah. And, you know, and that's just it. And we sort of started our conversation about that. So if I were planning a trip to Niagara Falls now, yeah, of course, you've got to see the falls. And you're right. I mean, people from all around the world, if you say to them anywhere that I've ever traveled, and I say, you know, I'm from Toronto, and they say, well, where? And I say, Niagara Falls. Oh, Niagara Falls. It doesn't matter where you are in the world. It's a place. So yeah, for sure, go and see the falls. Absolutely. There's something called the Whitewater Walk, which is, it's not far from Niagara Falls. It's about a, you know, 3 or 4 minute drive just down the river. And it's run by Niagara Parks. It's an incredible spot. You get into an elevator. The elevators, I mean, they're doing it, you know, with the pandemic a little bit differently, but it can only hold 6 people. It was, you know, built 70 years ago. This elevator takes you down to the bottom of the gorge. You then walk through this tunnel and you come out to a boardwalk that's about 300 meters. And it's right in front of this, you know, Class 6 wild water.
Wow.
You've never seen water or a gorge like this. I mean, it is just absolutely breathtaking. And the power in just listening to it. There's a place called the Niagara Glen, which is just then a little bit further down. So the Niagara Glen was, it's again, you get to this area, you park, you go down these stairs into this beautiful trailed system. And it's the same thing. You can go, they've got these gigantic boulders, and you notice people walking around with what looks like a mattress on their back. And they're boulderers. They're people who climb boulders, and they put these big pads underneath the boulders so that when they climb and fall, they've got something soft. I mean, there's hundreds of these.
Wow. I have never, ever seen that, or even like had an opportunity to watch it, someone do it, or ever heard of this. And where is this? What is it called?
It's called the Niagara Glen. And it's got more biodiversity than any other place in Canada. It's just stunning.
So I guess what you're saying is that we all need to go out and do a documentary for us to actually figure out where it is that we live. Now I get it. That's quite interesting that you said that, because we've been around and I've been here all my life and I've never heard of this. So that's quite interesting that it's right under our nose. And sometimes isn't that funny? Is that the very same thing that we're seeking elsewhere is right in front of us.
Yeah.
And we don't see it.
And that's, you know, you're a documentary maker, I am too. And that's the great thing, right? Is if you can give people a different perspective of something that they thought they knew really well, then, you know, you're getting somewhere, right? And the other, you know, the whirlpool is another place you can go and have a look at that. You can take the aero car, you know, across. That aero car is a really interesting story because it was built, I think, in 1906. And there were people that were, you know, trying to escape from, you know, from Canada. And they were, you know, they were told, oh, yeah, you know, you just take this aero car across. And when you get across, because at one point it actually stopped on the other side. It wasn't just a continuous run. So they pay somebody $100 to get in this. And then when it stopped at the other side, they thought they were in America and they, run away, not realizing they were still in Canada.
Now, I want to ask, I think that was why would anyone want to escape from Canada? I think Canada was, I thought it was the other way around.
Well, it might have been the other way around.
But I'm just kidding. Now, it's quite interesting. We see a lot of animated sequences of the battles, et cetera, that were shown in the film. How did you decide on which battles you were going to choose? There was a reenactment of several battles, and there are several significant battles that we see being reenacted in the Niagara region. For example, at Fort Erie, every August, we have the bloody battle that took place in 1812. There is a Chippewa battlefield park in the Niagara area. How did you choose that, and how difficult was that for the reenactment for the film?
Yeah, so what we wanted to do, the tough part about the animations, and it's something to watch for when you're screening the documentary. Normally, if you move from live action, so stuff that we've filmed with our camera, into the animated world,
right,
if you watch pretty well any film, I mean, unless it's a very expensive Hollywood film, there's usually a really obvious transition between those two scenes.
And I noticed a difference here, because when you did, for example, one of the scenes, you progressively moved it from real, where you're seeing it green, and you created that black and white sequence. And you had this gradual shifting overlay of the black and white onto the real, and it moved then into that sort of animation. And that was really, really well done.
And it actually fooled me. I mean, when our animator would send back his rushes, and am I watching animation or is this real? So when yes, we're going by the Adam Beck hydroelectric plant, the animator actually takes control of the scene before he opens up the hydroelectric plant to let us see what goes inside. Before those walls go up, it's actually animated, but it looks identical to the live action. I mean, the guy who, Matt Knight, the animator, it took him months and months and months to do. And it might be a subtlety that might be left lost on some viewers, but I think the fact that you just never ever see a transition I just find it just brilliant.
Yes, and that is actually the brilliance of that animator and being able to move it seamlessly between the two worlds. We've been in conversation with Mitch Azaria, and wow, what a conversation it's been. We've been talking about the TVO original, Tripping the Niagara, a stunning documentary that enables viewers to fly like a red-tailed hawk along the lower portion of the Niagara River. Stay tuned, we've got the last portion of today's show. You don't want to miss it. You want to know where you can get a hold of Mitch and where this movie is going to be seen, where this documentary is going to be seen. So stay tuned. I'm going to take a short break right now and I will be right back.
Stream us live at saga960am.ca.
In Focus with Annie J Koshy, and we are just wrapping up an amazing conversation with Mitch Azaria, executive producer at Good Earth Productions. From a production perspective, were there any particular parts of the entire process, Mitch, that stood out for you?
Yeah, there were moments of great difficulty, and there were moments that just were like aha moments. So a great difficulty was something that really surprised us. So the forecast for the next 4 days that we were filming in, I think it was sort of the end of August, was brilliant sunshine. So, woke up, looked out and thought, well, I mean, it's really, really bright, but I don't see the sun. And we couldn't figure it out. And we meet downstairs and we're in the parking lot and we're going, I can see shadows. There's obviously lots of sun, but the sky is white. And it took us all of that day to figure out that that was the California smoke that was had come across the jet stream.
Oh.
And so, you know, it was in locally a beautifully sunny day, but you couldn't see the sun. And that stayed that way for about 4 days. And it was, I mean, you know, not challenging. It was very expensive because the crew was, you know, was sort of sitting still going, well, you know, these are great days. So in some days, in some shots, it can really work because, you know, again, as you know, if you diffuse light and there's, you know, and there's no, you know, sort of hard sun, especially when we're shooting with a drone, we're not so worried about all of a sudden pointing in towards the sun, right? So in some, in the scenes within the forest, for instance, it worked really, really well because you don't right. need the sun, but you do need lots of light, right?
Right.
But if you have a lot of sky and you're seeing a lot of white, it's not working so well. So that was one of the challenges. One of the great moments to me was when we got in the car with the person from Niagara. And the first thing he said to me was, you know, this whole area is a park and it was established in 1885. And I said, wait up, Banff, because I used to do a park series. I said, Banff, the first national park in Canada was established in 1885. You're telling me this was a park, this has been a park for, you know, as long as Banff's been a park? And he said, yeah. And the background to that is that it was getting very industrial around the falls. And there were a lot of hustlers and there was a lot of corruption. It was, you know, somebody would say, I'll take you and your family down to the, you know, the foot of the falls to have a look at it. I've got this beautiful staircase. And they'd size you up and down and you'd go down for a dollar. And when you got down there, because you were well-dressed, they'd say, well, but it's $5 to come back up. You know? So there's a lot of stuff going on. And that was one of the reasons why they created this park so that they could kind of establish, you know, criteria for, you know, what could be there and the no industry and no polluting and so forth.
Now, was there a particular pivot moment for you in the making?
I think that moment came, I was telling you that, you know, John and I, the director, were scouting. And I think that moment came when we realized, as we've talked about, that there's so much more to this area than the falls. And so when we, you know, when we got to Whitewater or when we got, you know, our first boat trip up the river and we saw this gorge that was, I mean, you know, I describe it as kind of a Colorado gorge, this 17 right. story gorge. I mean, we thought, who would have thought this was here? This is, right. we're in Southern Ontario. And there's something that, you know, I haven't seen something like this since I was in the Arctic. I mean, it's just absolutely stunning. It's what you expect to see in the Rockies or in the high north, but to see it in Southern Ontario was a moment where both of us looked at each other and went, yeah, this is where we make the film.
Now, it's quite interesting you say that. I know in the creation of my film, I had over 10 hours of footage. And it does prove to be the most hardest part of filmmaking is in the editing process. What was the editing process like for this particular film?
It was way easier than you think, because for the Rideau, we literally turned the camera on, went for 4 hours and turned the camera off. And our intention on this film was more or less to do the same thing. We wanted to fly, you know, we figured we had 3 hours, so we had, 180 minutes. We wanted to fly 10, 18 minute flights. And so for us, the challenge was, where are those 18 minute flights going to come? And then, you know, how we map those out. So we knew that we wanted to do 18 of them. And oh, sorry, 10 of 10, 18 minute flights. Boy, my math is terrible. So we knew we wanted to do those. The hard part came to try and figure out, you know, okay, so the drone's going to go down this street, then it's going to lift up over these trees, then it's going to kind of come around and, you know, start going back down the river. And where, you know, and where's our, you know, where's our drone operator going to be? How many trees can he, you know, potentially hit and so forth? So we had these large chunks. So to answer your question, the editing wasn't extremely challenging.
Now, how documentary films usually have a sort of a time period. How did you determine 3 hours for this? And was that something that was required, that you had to fill a certain time frame? Or was it that there was a particular reason why you went for 3 hours?
Yeah, we had done 4 hours for the Rito, and right. We were getting more or less the same amount of budget to do right. the Niagara, but the pandemic was costly, so it probably added 25% to our costs. Right. So we reduced the film from 4 hours to 3 hours. So I mean, I'd love to give you a more creative reason.
Yeah, and actually, you know, it's quite interesting you say that, because our industries have been the hardest hit via COVID. And the very fact that TVO has been able to put this out during a pandemic, I put my documentary out during a pandemic. The entire editing process began as soon as we went into lockdown, because we had just finished shooting in February. And it was a time where everyone was back in the caves licking their wounds, and I was out there battling like you know, and we're getting it out there. The entire ad campaign, getting the marketing out for it, pushing it out, getting interest, you know, building up regarding it. We actually took a path that most people were not doing at the time, and they picked it up later. But you did the editing process during and the shooting in the prime of the pandemic. And that was a challenge, I'm sure.
The editing in that way was really challenging, because, as you know, the traditional way is that you sit with your editor and exactly. you've got a paper script, and you're working together to form this. Well, we had to do that remotely, and if you cut a sequence together and you play it back, and in our case, you know, there were some really important things that we had to see really closely. Well, we'd have to do it, you know, on Zoom, and that's just not a great way to.
Yeah, and it can be challenging from the color, you know, grading to the Foley work that has to happen, and all of that, because it's apparent when the drone is flying that there is sound that's been used to enhance the sound of the cars pulling up and cars going away. And someone like myself, I'm paying attention to that when I'm watching the film, right? And that comes from someone who's in. Well, where can people find you on social media, Mitch?
I bet you know.
Oh, well, that's true. Well, I think most of the information with regard to the film can be found if you actually look for Tripping the Niagara on Instagram. I believe there's a Facebook page called Tripping the Niagara, and there is a public website called, I believe it's at www.trippingtheniagara.com. And for yourself, Mitch, where can people get a hold of you if they want to see some of your work?
GoodEarthProductions.com. The interesting thing about the Facebook page is that there's, you know, if you want to see us working behind the scenes, you know, flying the drone or working with stickers, or there's some great behind the scenes little shorts there that are kind of fun to watch.
And it is for anyone who is aspiring to be a documentary filmmaker. This mm-hmm. is a great opportunity for you to get some behind the scenes about it. Well, there you have it. The TVO original Tripping the Niagara will air on TVO Sunday, April the 4th, 2021 at 7 p.m. and 10 p.m. EST. And it is available to stream anytime across Canada on tvo.org or the TVO YouTube channel beginning Friday, April the 2nd from at 7 p.m. EST. Yes.
I think also it's on the Friday the 2nd. So Friday
yes, the 2nd. Beginning Friday this April yeah. 2nd, 2021 at 7 p.m. And right. If you want any further information, you can reach out to me here at Saga960. That's info at sauga960am.ca. Attention Annie or the Ninja. If you've missed out on any of my live shows, you can tune in on Tuesdays for a repeat show from 9 to 10 p.m. You can also tune in onto our website at www.saga960am.ca, where there will be a podcast of this and other great shows. Have a great Saturday afternoon. Mitch, thank you so much for joining us. It's been an absolute pleasure to have you here for us to speak with you.
It was so much fun, Annie. Thanks for having me.
Well, stay safe and continue to be your badass self.
No radio? No problem. Stream us live on saga960am.ca.